ます。
Okay, good evening, everybody. Welcome to our presentation on holding and conducting meetings under the Brown Act. I'm Brian Washington, the County Council and the County Council of Marin County, I should say. And we're having this presentation because the Board of Supervisors wanted to provide an opportunity for all its board members and commission members to receive some updated Brown Act training. So we're happy to be here today. Before we get started, I'm going to ask Jason Balderrama to give the technical instructions for the meeting today.
Thank you, Brian. So captions are available within Zoom, and to enable them, the instructions are on screen, but you can select live transcript, show subtitle to turn them on. You can also access the subtitle settings there to change the font size. And if you want the captions to be in a different place other than the default, which is the bottom, you can drag and drop it to wherever you want to. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jason. If we could go to the next slide. So I'm Brian Washington. As I indicated, I'm the County Council of Marin County. I've been the County Council for about 5.5 years. And with me today are two of our deputy county councils who I hope you, or some of you, have had a chance to meet, I'm sure, both four-ish year veterans of our office, Brandon Halter and Kate Stanford. And we're going to walk you through an overview of the Brown Act. It's going to take about 35 or 40 minutes, I think, our presentation. And what I would ask is that we go ahead and give the presentation straight through. And we've left plenty of time for questions at the end. So you can raise your hand at the end and we'll be happy to take your questions. So our presentation today, we're gonna talk about the purpose of the Brown Act, talk about what governmental bodies are subject to the act, which meetings are covered, talk a little bit about the agenda requirements and some of the posting and distribution requirements. For the agenda, talk about some of the mechanics of conducting meetings under the Brown Act and how it applies to some conduct outside of meetings. Talk a little bit about closed sessions and penalties, although we're not going to emphasize that because most of our board and commission members don't have to worry about those areas too much, we hope. And we're going to talk about some Brown Act resources that are available and then have, as I indicated, plenty of time for questions. Next slide, please. So what is the purpose of the Brown Act? The Brown Act contains very strong statements of its purpose. And that is that public boards, commissions, et cetera, exist to aid in the conduct of the people's business. It's the intent of the law that their actions be taken openly and that their deliberations be conducted openly. I wanted to read you a couple other statements of purpose the legislature has provided for the Brown Act. The people of the state do not yield their sovereignty to the agencies which serve them. The people insist on remaining informed so that they may retain control over the instruments they have created. So it's important to keep those purposes in mind when you're reviewing the Brown Act and trying to implement it. So I think we're going to go to Kate to talk about governmental bodies subject to the Brown Act.
Yes, next slide, please. And next slide. So the Brown Act applies to local agencies, which include counties, cities, school districts, municipal corporations, districts, political subdivisions, or any board, commission, agency thereof. The Brown Act applies for local agencies. There's a different law that applies for state agencies and state bodies, which is the Bagley-Keene Act. And the Brown Act doesn't apply to the judiciary, the judicial branch, or judiciary boards and commissions. Next slide, please. So specifically, the Brown Act applies to legislative bodies of local agencies. Legislative bodies include the governing body of the local agency, a commission, committee, board, or other body of a local agency, that's created by charter, ordinance, resolution, or other formal act of the legislative body, and standing committees of a legislative body that have continuing subject matter jurisdiction or whose meeting schedule is fixed by a formal action of the body. Next slide, please. So thinking about examples in Marin County, we have the Board of Supervisors that's covered by the Brown Act. That's the governing body of our local agency. And then commissions that have been created by ordinance, resolution, or other actions. So we have decision-making commissions like the Planning Commission and the Personnel Commission, and advisory bodies like the Human Rights Commission, Design Review Board, the Mental Health Board, the Youth Commission. And then there are other bodies subject to the Brown Act that aren't directly part of the county, like the school districts, city councils, special district boards. There are also, under very specified circumstances, situations in which private entity boards and commissions may be subject to the Brown Act. These tend to be nonprofit corporations, and they may be subject to the Brown Act if they're exercising delegated authority from a covered legislative body, or if they receive funding from a local agency and a member of the local agency's governing board is also a voting member of their board. So that doesn't come up too much. And just to note that just receiving funding from a local agency doesn't make a nonprofit subject to the Brown Act. Next slide, please. One exception to the Brown Act are ad hoc committees. Ad hoc committees are temporary advisory committees that are composed of less than a quorum of members of the legislative body. And they tend to have like a limited purpose. So an example would be if you have a 5-member board and the chair appoints 2 members to create a nominating committee for the next year's officers, that would be an ad hoc committee and they would not need to comply with the Brown Act. Next slide. Oh, I think I'm turning to Brandon now.
Thanks, Kate. We'll go to the next slide, please. So here we're going to talk about what meetings are covered. Meetings is defined right there in the statute. Any congregation of a majority of the members of a legislative body at the same time and location to hear, discuss, deliberate, or take action on any item that is within the subject matter jurisdiction of the body. That means what it sounds like. It doesn't, a meeting does not have to be one at which the board is taking some specific action in order to be considered a meeting under the Brown Act. It can be a meeting with just deliberation, for example. And so we'll hear lots of terms thrown around that define or that describe that kind of a meeting: workshops, study sessions, retreats, that kind of thing. Those are all still subject to the Brown Act because they can meet this definition that's in there in the statute. Next slide, please. There are exceptions to those, to the definition, or sorry, there are exceptions to the requirement that the meeting meet the requirements of the Brown Act. They are listed there. There are a couple of bulleted points. Individual conversations between board members, obviously that's not a meeting of a quorum of the board. Certain public conferences, you can have a majority of the board attend a public conference, and that won't be subject to the Brown Act, provided the public conference is something of general interest and or of interest to public entities. Community meetings open to the public, attendance at other entities, public meetings, social events. These are gatherings outside meetings of the legislative body, and provided they are sort of general interest and the legislative body is not convening separately at those events to try to meet and discuss outside the presence of the public, then the legislative body can attend those without complying with the Brown Act. Next slide, please. Regular meetings. So there's a couple of different kinds of meetings that we're gonna discuss. Regular meetings, each legislative body except for advisory and standing committees must, by ordinance, resolution, bylaw, or other rule, provide for the time and place of holding regular meetings. So our practice tip on that is that the organizing document or rules for the body should specify the time and place for the regular meetings in those rules or by a resolution. Next slide, please. Another kind of meeting is a special meeting. And this is a meeting that's held at a time or location different than the regular meeting. Regular meeting set forth in those rules, those bylaws. Special meeting is something that is not held at that regular time and place. Examples are listed here. Planning Commission's regular meeting is set for 9 a.m. The commission calls a meeting for 8 a.m. Different start time makes it a special meeting. Another example there, site visit, field trip. Sometimes we have boards or commissions that have specific topics of interest for that board or commission. The Planning Commission, for example, might be interested in a piece of real property or observing some kind of development. If they want to make a site visit to that that location and they're doing it in a way that meets the requirements of the Brown Act, it doesn't really matter that it's off site. They still have to comply with the requirements of the Brown Act because it's a special meeting. Next slide, please. So special meetings, the notice must specify the time and place of the special meeting and the business to be transacted. One of the other differences between special meetings and regular meetings is that the agenda for the special meeting must be posted at least 24 hours in advance. That's a little tighter of a timeline than it is for regular meetings, which are 72 hours, as Kate will get into later. And the limitation on special meetings is that no other business may be conducted at the special meeting other than what you have identified in the agenda. And special meetings also they must allow for public comment on that specific agenda item, but they really are to discuss just what is on the agenda, that one specific item the specific items identified for the special meeting. Next slide, please. So a few slides on teleconferencing. Before COVID time period, the government code contained provisions by which the legislative bodies could meet via teleconferencing, but those rules were pretty onerous. As you can see here, must post agenda at the teleconference location. As you can imagine, if you have a body that is made up of members meeting from various locations, one of those members is meeting from, Manila in the Philippines, you still have to post the agenda on the hotel door of that board member or whatever it is. That is a difficult requirement to manage. Agenda must identify the teleconference location. Location must be publicly accessible. Public must be able to comment. Generally, at least a quorum must participate from locations within the boundary of the agency. Again, this is the sort of pre-COVID rules on teleconferencing. Next slide, please. With the COVID-19 pandemic, however, new rules were developed, first on an emergency basis and then on a statutory basis, that sort of relaxed the circumstances or the requirements for meeting via teleconference. The Brown Act currently allows for these easier to manage teleconferencing rules. Officials have recommended or mandated social distancing and or where when the meeting in person would pose a risk to health and safety. The body can continue using these modified teleconference rules if it makes a finding every 30 days that the health officials recommend social distancing, or if it makes a new finding that meeting in person poses a public health and safety risk. So that's all currently in effect. Next slide, please. When operating under these emergency rules, the legislative body must do the following: allow the public audiovisual or telephonic access to the meeting. You got to protect statutory and constitutional rights of all parties at all times. Take no action on the agenda items if a technical issue prevents the public from participating or observing. So if Zoom goes down for a particular agenda item, you can't take any action on that if the public was prevented from participating and observing. May not require public comments to be submitted in advance and must provide an opportunity for the public to address the body and offer comments in real time. Next slide, please. Very recent update to these points of interest is new legislation that was signed last Friday that extended those teleconference rules through the end of 2023, added a few options for board members teleconferencing without meeting traditional requirements when a quorum of the board participates on site and the public is allowed to participate remotely. And next slide, please. With that, I will turn it back to Brian.
Okay, thank you, Brandon. Sorry, I had a little trouble unmuting there. Next slide, please. So let's talk about the role of the agenda in the Brown Act, which is kind of the core of the act. In general, the body is limited. The board that we're talking about is limited to considering the items listed on the posted agenda. And we've cited the statute for you there. The agenda, you know, in effect, provides notice to the public of what's going to be considered, and needs to let the public know what actions are going to be taken, what items are going to be discussed. Next slide. So the agenda, the statutory language requires that the agenda provide a brief general description of each item of business to be transacted or discussed. That brief general description does not have to exceed 20 minutes. So it doesn't have to be a particularly lengthy description, just has to let people know what the subject matter is that's going to be discussed, what actions might be taken. Practice tip here is make sure you don't accidentally limit yourself in a way you don't want to. For example, if you write discussion only on the agenda, that essentially prevents the board from taking action on that item. And you know, many times that's fine. People just want to have a discussion about things, but you can limit yourself by adding things like discussion only to an agenda. Whereas if you have a more broad statement, something like considerations of policies regarding purchasing, the board could adopt the policies, the board could decide not to adopt the policies. There's more options there. Next slide. A couple of just basic mechanics. The agenda has to specify the time and location of the meeting. It also has to specify the location of where any documents that were distributed less than 72 hours before the meeting can be picked up. And Kate will talk later about what documents have to be made available. Next slide. So are there any exceptions to this basic agenda rule that I just described? Yes, they are. They're pretty narrow exceptions for the most part. Board members can make a brief response to public testimony. So that's something that's not on the agenda that can occur. Brief is not specifically defined in the Brown Act, and we can talk about that a bit in a moment. Board members can ask a question of staff for clarification, can make a brief announcement or report of their activities, make a referral to staff to report back at a subsequent meeting, or direct staff to place items on the agenda for future meetings. So those are things that do not require an agenda item to occur. There was a case in Marin County, some of you may remember, 6 or 7 or 8 years ago, where a 19-minute discussion ensued about an item that was not on the agenda, with some comments from board members and comments from staff. And the Superior Court found that 19 minutes was not brief, and that discussion, you know, should not have been permitted under the Brown Act. So, you know, brief probably just means a minute or two generally. Next slide. So can you add something to the agenda after it was posted? Occasionally you can. And this is usually referred to as urgency adds. And there's two requirements for this. You need to, there needs to be a need to take immediate action. And that need to take immediate action needs to have arisen after the posting of the agenda. So for example, our Board of Supervisors posts their agendas on Thursday and the board meetings are on Tuesday. If on Monday there was a new development on a legal case that I needed to talk to the board about in closed session, we could make these findings at the meeting on Tuesday that there is a need to take immediate action, and that need came to our attention after the posting of the agenda. That subject could then be properly discussed at the meeting. There's also some situations where items can be added during times of emergencies, when there's, you know, a severely crippling event that endangers public health and safety. That does not happen very often, probably never for our boards and commissions. Next slide. So The public has a right to comment on every item on the agenda before action is taken. The most common way that this occurs is by having public having a staff report on an item, having some board discussion, and then taking public comment, and then the board acting, and then doing that for each item on the agenda. There is an alternative way that I don't think very many bodies use, but a few do. I know the Orange County Board of Supervisors uses it, where it takes public comment on all items on the agenda at the start of the meeting, and then proceeds to the meeting without going back to the public. That's an unusual way to do it, but that does also comply with the Brown Act. Next, I think I'm going to Kate now for posting and distribution.
Thank you, Brian. Next slide, please. Yeah, so as Brian was just explaining, the agenda is very important in informing the public about what's happening at a legislative body meeting and ensuring the public has information. And so the Brown Act includes strict requirements about how that agenda is shared with the public, including posting requirements. So the agenda must be posted in a location that's freely accessible to the public. And for regular meetings, it needs to be posted at least 72 hours ahead of the meeting, and for special meetings, at least 24 hours ahead of time. And if the agenda is posted in a location that's behind doors that are closed and locked over the weekend, those weekend hours don't count towards those hour requirements. So in the county, we place the agendas in a protected bulletin board outside of the first arch of the Civic Center so that it's available to the public basically at all times and gives them ample notice before a meeting. Next slide, please. The Brown Act also includes some requirements for posting agendas on the web, the internet, and we have websites here for the county. And so the agenda needs to be posted on the agency's website if it's the agenda for the governing body. So for example, the Board of Supervisors agenda is always posted on the website. And there's also a requirement that agendas be posted for a committee, commission, or board of the local agency if the members are compensated for their appearance and one or more of the members is also a member of the governing body. The general practice here, I believe, is that we post agendas for all of our boards and commissions. I believe they all have websites that are accessible through the Board of Supervisors websites, and they're posted there, and that's a good practice. But it's important to remember that posting agendas online on the web does not supplant the requirement to also post it publicly in a physical location, even if nobody goes there anymore. Next slide, please. So as Brian sort of mentioned, the materials that are considered by the legislative body also have to be made available to the public. So any writings or materials that the board is considering at an open meeting are public records and need to be available for public inspection. And if a writing is not provided to the board more than 72 hours in advance of the meeting, then it needs to be made available for public inspection at the same time that it's distributed to a majority of the body. So a good practice is that if a staff member's bring or an outside group is bringing a presentation to a board meeting, that they bring extra copies that are available for the public that's attending to inspect, and just to make sure that those materials are shared with the public. Next slide, and I think it's back to Brandon.
All right, thanks, Kate. So now we'll talk a bit about conducting the meeting. Next slide, please. Public participation. The Brown Act requires the body to allow the public to comment on matters on the agenda before or during consideration of the item. You heard Brian mention that a while back. The agency may adopt reasonable regulations on time allotted for public testimony, such as limiting the time per speaker or limiting the total time allotted to public testimony. Reasonable time regulation must, however, ensure intent of allowing public testimony on matters on agenda is carried out. And obviously, you know, in the absence of a definition on what reasonable regulation means, I suppose there can be different interpretations, but in general, we cannot really imagine a situation where allowing a time period of less than a minute would be considered very reasonable. We think probably even a minute is stretching it unless the circumstances really justify that. And most entities in general use a time limitation of 3, 4, 5 minutes in that time frame. Also, it should be noted that the public body can't prohibit criticism of the public body itself, but it can adopt reasonable rules related to decorum as long as free speech rights are respected. Next slide, please. May not require any member of the public to register his or her name or complete a questionnaire as a condition of attendance. If an attendance list is posted at or near the entrance or circulated at the meeting, it has to have a disclaimer on it. You have to disclose to people that they that completion of that document, filling in their name, is voluntary. Next slide, please. Loss of quorum. When there is no quorum, there is no meeting. You do have to meet the definition of a meeting, the majority of the board members, quorum, being present. No action can be taken if there is no meeting. Do not prepare minutes if the meeting did not have a quorum. It sometimes comes up, though, the question, can the board members who have, or the members of the body who have attended the meeting, even if there isn't a quorum, it isn't a meeting under the Brown Act, can they still have a discussion among those few members who are there? The Brown Act doesn't prohibit that, but we do want to note as a practice tip that there are practical considerations around doing that. The absent board members might want to be involved in a discussion on that subject, and so it may make more sense to defer it until a quorum of the board can attend. That's our tip on that. Next slide, please. Voting secret ballots are prohibited. Again, this legislation is all about openness, transparency. The body must publicly report any vote taken and the vote or abstention of each member present for that action. Next slide, please. Agency recording of the meeting. The Brown Act doesn't require meetings to be recorded. However, if the body records a meeting, recording is now a public document. It's subject to production under the Public Records Act. The recording may be erased or deleted 30 days after the recording is made. Next slide, please. And also, we must allow members of the public to record the meeting as well. Bodies can impose restrictions on those recordings if they make reasonable findings that they're becoming a persistent disruption, but that's actually pretty narrow. Exceptions written down in the statute in such a way that it's pretty narrow. So be careful about that one. Next slide, please. And with that, I think I turn it back to Brian.
Okay, thank you, Brandon. Next slide. So let's talk about the prohibition on serial meetings. The basic principle I stated here is deliberations of public bodies should be conducted openly and their actions should be taken openly. That's what the Brown Act's mandate is. As a little bit of history, when my brother worked for the City of San Diego Planning Commission in the late 80s, early 90s, the Planning Commission used to go to lunch before their meetings and go through the agenda and talk about what they were going to do. And then they would go to their meeting and do what they just talked about at lunch. That is not allowed. As of 1994, the legislature enacted amendments to the Brown Act. And I'm going to take a moment with this because it's pretty important. And the quote is on the slide from the law. Majority members of a legislative body shall not, outside a meeting authorized by this chapter, use a series of communications of any kind directly or through intermediaries to discuss, deliberate, or take action on items of business that is within the subject matter jurisdiction of the legislative body. So as you probably noticed, I was trying to emphasize that's very, very broad language. And it doesn't mean that if we didn't take an action, it's all okay, right, Brian? No. It talks about discussing or deliberating. Doing that with a majority of a body is not allowed under the Brown Act. The emphasis is you know, not only decisions being made should be made in public, but the discussion and the deliberations on those decisions should be made in public. Next slide. So here's ways that this can go wrong, what's referred to as a daisy chain. If board member A talks to board member B then talks to board member C, and board member C then talks to board member D about, and this is a five-member board, and actually four folks have talked. So a supermajority of the board has engaged in a discussion outside of the Brown Act. So hub and spoke is another example. Let's say I talk to board members one about an item and we discuss it and deliberate on what's gonna happen. I then go talk to board member number two and have that same discussion. And then I go and talk to board member number three. That's now a majority of the board that has just discussed and deliberated on an item within their jurisdiction through a hub and spoke method. So the you know, the key way to avoid problems under this, as is listed here, is if somebody, a staff member, like the example I just gave of myself, is talking to multiple board members, you shouldn't be making inquiries into what other board members thought. So board member A shouldn't be asking what board member B and C said about the issue. Next slide. Beware of email. So that slide really says it all, I think, even beyond the Brown Act, beware of email. But in terms of the Brown Act and what we're talking about, serial meetings, if you use email incorrectly, you can accidentally violate the Brown Act. If somebody sends an informational email to all members of a board and commission and somebody responds to all and starts a substantive discussion about the issues before the board, that is a discussion that is a discussion or deliberation on an item within that board's jurisdiction that is not allowed under the Brown Act. So as the practice tip indicates, you really shouldn't be hitting reply all on a meeting to your board or commission, an email to your board or commission, unless that email is, you know, just about scheduling or some ministerial manner. Next slide. So here's an example, a case study for you. An email is circulating among majority members of a board and sent to the chairperson and secretary of the agency. So they've had a substantive email discussion about something within their jurisdiction, a majority of the board members. The board members then post that email to the agency website, and a printed version is available at the next meeting. Have they cured any problem there? Go ahead and hit the button. No, they have not. So the California Attorney General says the emailing among board members violates the Brown Act because you're deliberating outside of a public meeting authorized by the Brown Act. And even though you're trying to cure it by making it public, that does not cure the issue. Next slide. And I think I touched upon this already. You know, the key for a staff member and having informational discussions with board members is to make sure you're not communicating the positions of other board members, of one board member to another board member, to ensure there's no Brown Act violation. I think we're going to Kate.
Yes, next slide, please. So obviously the focus of the Brown Act is open meetings, public access, public participation, but the Brown Act does recognize that there are certain circumstances where confidentiality is required, and there are limited exceptions to the open meeting requirement for what's called closed session, where the legislative body is able to meet behind closed doors. The focus of this presentation is open session, so I won't go into much detail, but I just wanna note that the exceptions, these closed session exceptions, have to be expressly authorized by statute. They're very narrowly construed. Some examples are if there's pending litigation, if it's an employee discipline matter, or if there's real estate negotiations. closed session items still need to be included on the agenda with brief description. And generally the legislative body has to report out after the closed session with sort of a brief summary of what occurred. Next slide, please. So you've heard all the rules. I'm sure you're really curious what happens when the rules are broken. And so we'll speak for a few minutes about penalties for Brown Act violations. So one of the big penalties is that any act taken when the Brown Act was violated can be invalidated. The Brown Act authorizes any person, including the district attorney, to bring a civil action alleging a Brown Act violation and seeking to invalidate the action. Before suing, the DA or the person should provide notice to the local agency, and the local agency has a small period of time to cure the violation, and then they can file suit. Brian referenced a case, it sounds like about 6 years ago. Luckily, I wasn't involved, but one thing that can happen in these civil lawsuits is that if the person alleging a Brown Act violation is successful, not only is the action invalidated, they can also be awarded attorney's fees, which can go up pretty quickly in litigation. So that can be a serious consequence. And then next slide, please. There's also potential criminal liability. It's a pretty high burden that individual board member has to knowingly attend a meeting that violates the Brown Act and needs to have intended to deprive the public of information. But if someone does meet that level of violation of the Brown Act, they can be subject to a misdemeanor criminal penalty. And then I'm going to pass it to Brandon for some resources about the Brown Act.
Thanks, Kate. This one's pretty basic. We're just setting out some sources you can conduct for additional information on the subject. Obviously, up there at the top is your friendly neighborhood county council. Please reach out with any questions. But also, we have some listed literature that California Attorney General's Office publication is from 2003. So that doesn't include the most recent amendments to the Brown Act, but there are some more recent publications in there as well, there at the end. Next slide, please, and I will pass it to Brian.
Okay, thank you, Brandon. Before we wrap it up, it looks like we have a bonus slide here. We just wanted to give some general advice about handling successful public meetings. As the slide says, you know, a well-conducted meeting instills public confidence and encourages engagement. A bit of formality and decorum can set a tone for an effective and orderly meeting. So we listed a few tips here, you know, making sure speakers are addressing their remarks to the chair or presiding officer of the meeting, making sure folks are you know, just common courtesy, waiting for recognition from the officer, the presiding officer before speaking, and adhering to time limits, keeping civil discourse civil and impersonal. Next slide. And, you know, following a common structure, I think is can be very helpful. I've listed a common structure for handling board meetings here: receiving a staff report, taking questions from the board commission members, receiving public comment, having the board members then discuss, deliberate, and, you know, take action if necessary. There are other ways to do that, but having a set expectation about how a meeting is going to proceed can be very helpful in making it effective. And, you know, looking for areas of agreement and enjoying yourself, of course, are always important. So I think we've reached the end of our presentation. And as I indicated, we can take some questions. I will quickly go through some of the questions that have been posted, and then we'll have Jason moderate a live Q&A. The first question I have from Lily Thomas: when can a governing body cut off public comment? Does everyone who is waiting have the right to comment? Brandon, do you want to tackle that one?
So the slides that I was going through talk about how the public body can institute reasonable regulations on time frame, decorum, things like that. I think one of the hallmarks of that approach is that it needs to treat everybody equally. So set up a time limitation that's 3 minutes and then apply it across the board. You can cut people off after 3 minutes, but you don't want to be in a situation where you're cutting someone off who for doing something that you allowed someone else to do. So you don't want to look like you're discriminating among viewpoints, I guess is how I would put it. I think in general, it's especially among a lot of the boards that we have present, it's generally a bad idea to try to cut off the number of comments or the public commenting on things, even if items go long, especially when you're talking about boards with quasi-adjudicative functions, the Planning Commission, the Personnel Commission. You need, as a matter of due process, sometimes to allow fulsome public comment, even if that gets long. So I would say the hallmark for me is that you need to treat people equally. You can impose reasonable regulations, but you should apply them across the board and let people speak. Brian, anything you want to add on that one?
No, that was excellent. We had a next question, Ken, from anonymous attendee. Can a person send an information email to each board member individually? The answer to that generally is yes. Emails like that often are sent to all board members as part of an agenda packet. That's probably the best way to do it. But yes, the answer is yes there. B asks, would you please email PowerPoint? Yes, I will. I will put my email in the chat and in this question and answer chat. And anybody who wants a copy of the PowerPoint, just email me and we'd be happy to send that. We have another anonymous attendee. What should a staff person do if they witness what they believe is a violation of the Brown Act? Kate, do you want to take that under penalties?
Sure. Depending on the context, I would definitely encourage you, if it happened in the past, I would encourage you to reach out to County Council. If it's happening in the moment, you could ask that tell the body to take a recess and reach out to County Council or reach out to your supervisor or someone else. Because in the moment, I think if you do want to stop it, if it's happening, and if it's happened in the past, consult with us. And Brian, do you want to add anything to that?
I don't. That excellent answer. Lily Thomas asks, do you have recommendations for level of detail for minutes? I don't think we really covered that. Yeah, that's not really a subject covered in the Brown Act. But in terms of minutes, most boards and commissions that I'm aware of do kind of action minutes. So they just briefly summarize what action was taken by the board. That is an approach that saves staff resources. Some boards and commissions take more detailed minutes, and if there are available staff resources to do that, that's completely appropriate. But at a minimum, you should have some action minutes. Leslie Dixon asks, are there requirements to post meeting minutes? Who can handle that one? I believe meeting minutes are normally approved by a body after they've held a meeting. And so in that respect, I think they would need to get posted on, with the item of approving minutes. I hope that answers that question. And if not, you can follow up live. Hi, Molly. This is Molly Cron, not Lily Thomas. Do you have recommendations for level of detail for minutes? I think we hit that, but let me know if we need to do that anymore. And then the last written question we'll take, and then we'll go live, is what does it mean to post a Zoom meeting location? I believe we're referring to the web link to get you to the Zoom meeting. I think that's what we were referring to there. Brandon or Kate, anything to add there?
I think that's right. Under the old teleconference rules, there might have been a reference to identifying physical locations for the meeting, but that's, I think, what we're referring to. If you're going to allow teleconferencing, you've got to allow the public to know how to access the meeting via video conference.
Okay, thanks, Brandon. I just put my email in the question and answer. I'll put it in the chat as well. Please send me, and my email is bwashington@marincounty.org. Just let me know if you need the slides, and I'd be happy to send those to you. And Jason, did you want to moderate some Q&A?
Thanks, Brian. So just turned on the ability for you all to raise your hand. So at the bottom of your toolbar, you'll see there's a raise hand button. You can also do it through keyboard shortcut. If you're on Windows, it's Alt and Y. And if you're on a Mac, it's Option and Y. So go ahead and raise your hand, and then we'll call on you in turn. I see the first question comes from Susan. So, Susan, please go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So you mentioned that everyone should have equal treatment if the meeting opens up with a 3-minute time limit for the speakers, the public to speak, then everyone should get those 3 minutes. I've been at numerous meetings where they'll start out at 3 minutes and then they'll realize, wow, there's so many people, we're going to be here till 3 a.m. And then they'll cut it back to 2 minutes and then they'll cut it back to 1 minute. Is that a violation of the Brown Act?
Go ahead, Brandon.
I think it's sort of intended to be a sliding scale, in my opinion. You need to have reasonable restrictions. So as long as you're not imposing it in a way that violates rights, you're not discriminating among viewpoint, you're not discriminating on any other protected basis. You're trying to be reasonable in terms of identifying the amount of time that you have available to you and the amount of speakers that you have, and you're making reasonable regulations mindful of those circumstances, then I can imagine a situation where that would be permissible, unless Brian waves me off of that. But that's obviously subject still to that caveat that I mentioned about the matter of business that's being conducted. There may be other circumstances that justify sticking very tightly to whatever it was you set out to do, if it was 3 minutes. And some of those meetings are like I mentioned, the meetings in which you're adjudicating something, you are making a decision that involves somebody's due process rights. You want to give everybody a fair shake. And that's obviously painfully vague and sort of common parlance, but that's how I would approach that issue.
Okay. So basically, yeah. If they get to a point and they say everybody from now on gets 2 minutes, that's okay. If they say everybody whose last name starts with R gets 2 minutes, everybody else gets one, then they're discriminating.
Yeah, I think that's a fair summary. I have been at meetings like that as well, and we generally advise our clients to try to gauge the amount of time they have available for public comment and set the per speaker limit at an appropriate amount of time to avoid that problem of having to shorten it during the hearing. But inevitably, sometimes they're surprised by how many people speak. So as long as there's a rational reason for imposing the rule, as Brandon indicated, I think that's appropriate.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next question is from Greg.
Yeah, thank you. So in my prior naive life, insofar as I knew anything about the Brown Act, sounded like a great thing that I was completely behind. Then I got appointed to a small local advisory board, and I finding it to be incredibly difficult to get anything done while feeling like I'm complying with it. I don't even want to make any decisions. I don't want to, what I'm trying to do is detangle some issues. We have a major issue in front of us. It's contentious. I'd like to break it apart and maybe create some working groups and get people to work on other parts of the problem. And at every turn, I just feel like I'm in danger of violating the Brown Act. And you know, there are a very small number of people who are kind of obstructionist in my view toward actually doing anything about this problem. And it just seems like a tool to, you know, kind of beat the advisory board up with, if you did that, you'd be in violation. And, you know, nothing I heard tonight really gave me any guidance for how to do anything outside the context of a meeting. And I'm getting the impression maybe that it can't be done. Any advice?
Okay, well, I don't see Kate or Brandon jumping for that one, so I'll start off a response. And thanks for the question, Greg. I do think the Brown Act can be challenging and impose a lot of rules, and it is in seeking that goal that everything is done openly and publicly in the public's view. So. I think, you know, you're not the first person who's been frustrated. In terms of things you can do to hopefully cut through some of that, I mean, you know, I talked about how critical it is in terms of designing your agenda items and wording your agenda items to, in a broad enough manner to let you accomplish what you want to accomplish. So, maybe that's one thing to consider. And if your advisory commission has a, county council representative, maybe schedule some time to talk to them about how you might be able to design agenda items to get more done. That's kind of the idea that comes to my mind.
The sense I have is that, like, so some of the things, and I don't want to get too specific, but, some of the things I'm doing in my role, it involves the county and county actions. My sense is that if I went off and talked to like county employees by myself and then brought that to the agenda, that would not be a violation. It would only be if I were to communicate with other board members about bringing these things to the agenda that would be a problem. Is that correct?
That is correct. That is correct. If you're a member of a 5-member board and you and two others go and have a discussion with county staff, that could be prohibited under the Brown Act, but you individually doing that is perfectly allowed.
Got it. All right, that helps. Thank you.
Hey, the next question comes from Rodrigo.
Hi, since everything is done on Zoom, and obviously you could see committees and the board of supervisors and other various committees, you can see them on Zoom, but some parts, like for the public participation, they have been no video. So the public cannot do presentations. Let's just say that the Latino guy who got beat up by the San Rafael Police Department, if he wanted to show his wounds or his whatever, all the damage that was done, or if another member of the public wanted to show some kind of graph, they can't show it. So is that permissible that the public cannot do a presentation or cannot show themselves? And also adding to that is sometimes some committee members, they persistently do not show themselves on video. And they just have it on no video, and then they take a vote. So you don't really know if it's that committee member who's voting. I'm just wondering, what is your opinion on visibility on Zoom?
So maybe I'll take the first part of your question and ask Brandon to take the second part. But in terms of the board, I believe Rodrigo and I may have discussed this before, but in terms of the Board of Supervisors meeting, the Board of Supervisors used to allow people to show themselves on Zoom when providing public comment. They had some folks who put on inappropriate material, and the board doesn't want to choose between speakers who can and cannot present their video. So the board's adopted a rule where no one can show themselves on video when providing public comment. That's an appropriate, legal, neutral rule. if somebody does want to show something to the board, they can always reach out to the county administrator's office or the clerk of the board's office. And, you know, we can see if there's an appropriate means to show some content that needs to be shown as part of an agenda item. But that is an appropriate rule that the board has adopted. And Brandon, do you want to handle the part about board member visibility?
I mean, the short answer is I'm not totally sure, actually. I'm not aware of a requirement in the recent emergency orders that require the board member to show their visual appearance. I think actually that even under the older rules, there were provisions to allow for access via technology that wouldn't involve video. But Brian, are you aware of any contrary provisions on that?
Yeah, I'm not. I mean, just as a best practice, I would agree with Rodrigo that it's a little hard to kind of know who's really engaged if you can't see them. And so I think we should be advising folks to show themselves when they're on a board or commission and are at a meeting. And, you know, that would be particularly important for like our planning commission members and our members who are hearing matters that are, you know, subject to due process requirements, fair hearing requirements. You know, folks, I think, need to be able to see who they're presenting to in those kind of situations.
Let me just add, because Brandon, you just mentioned something that on posting, if a commissioner or a official is, let's just say in the Philippines, that they have to post it on their door because they're not in the vicinity. So in a way, this seems like visibility is extremely important. They might be in Mexico, in which case they're inaccessible. They should not be part of the quorum.
So I think I understand the concern. This is the way the Brown Act was written. There's those two different sets of rules, and it did allow under certain circumstances for a board member to vote via video conference and not be physically present within the jurisdictional boundaries. And that's just how the law was written. I would note further though on the security idea, I understand that concern. I agree with Brian that in terms of the way we advise our boards, we would certainly want to meet the spirit of the law in terms of transparency, and that probably means showing your video. But also there are probably ways, if I was advising the board you know, ahead of time in terms of how to conduct the meeting, technologically speaking, as you've seen today here, we have abilities to moderate the way people have access to the meeting. So, you know, provide special panelist instructions and passwords only to your board members and make sure that they sign in through that mechanism so you can verify their identity, you know, that way. There are other technological protections you can put in place that just sort of help address those kinds of concerns. But in terms of the Brown Act, you know, this is really just kind of the way it's laid out in terms of teleconferencing capabilities.
Okay.
Brian, I'm not seeing any more hands.
Okay, I think one more question popped into the question and answer. What should a sitting member of a Brown Act governed body do in a Zoom meeting when members of the public address the body using the chat function, which is invisible to the general public? So there should not be chatting among board members, board or commission members with the chat function if the chat function can't be seen. And I think we would generally recommend not having the chat function enabled for meetings under the Brown Act. Okay, well, I think, Jason, are we still, are we done with questions?
Yes, I think so.
All right, well, we really appreciate everybody coming today. If you have questions, please feel free to reach out. Again, my email is bwashington@marincounty.org. And thank you for your service to the county on boards and commissions. And let us know if we can be of any help. Thank you.